Namaskar and welcome to the fifth edition of our special series on India-UN partnership to mark 75th anniversary of United Nations. Listeners may recall, India has been one of the founding members of the world body. Today, we are observing World Food Day. This year, the theme is Grow, Nourish, Sustain Together. We have with us Dr. Bishow Parajuli, World Food Program Representative and Country Director, India. Mr. Bishow Parajuli joined as the World Food Programme Representative and Country Director to India on 1st September 2019. Before this assignment, he served as the UN Resident Coordinator in Zimbabwe for the past 5 years. Bishow Parajuli has 35 years' experience in development, humanitarian affairs, diplomacy, fundraising and management. He has earlier served in various capacities at WFP headquarters in Rome, in Myanmar, Indonesia, Bangladesh, Yemen, Egypt, Mozambique and Botswana. Welcome, Mr. Parajuli.
Thank you very much. Namaste. It's such a pleasure to be here.
It's really nice to have a person who has such an experience across the globe, be it Asia, be it Africa, and be it Europe. So based on your experiences and the very fact that the World Food Programme has got the Nobel Peace Prize this year, how do you look at the role and the contribution of this world body?
First of all, you know, all the staff across 80 countries are extremely humble and very pleased with this honor of Nobel Peace Prize award to the World Food Programme. Over 17,000 staff across 80 countries in a very difficult situation, sometimes putting their life on the front, work, helping others. So this is really humbling and joyful. Additionally, it's also a joyful moment for all our government partners, donors, civil society organization, and volunteers who support the World Food Programme. So it is really fantastic. Additionally, it is also honor because it values the importance of food. It values that there is hunger in the world and we can all join and we must to address to reach to zero hunger.
Yeah, you know, you rightly pointed out the context of zero hunger, which has been one of the primary goals of the WFP as part of the UN agenda in the years to come to say so. How do you look at the contribution of WFP across the globe and how far has the global solidarity been a part in this entire campaign?
WFP is in existence for the last 60 years, including in India, we are here for 50 years. In fact, we have excellent cooperation and support from donors and partners. That's why we are able to do what we are able to do. Without their help and support, we cannot do it. And we are extremely valued for our cooperation and support. You know, food is the basic rights and basic need for everybody. And in this world of 21st century of plenties, to have 690 million people going still hungry, it's a concern. And it must be a concern for us. And the zero hunger can be achieved. There is support being provided. WFP reaches out to over 100 million people around the world every day with meals. In some countries, over half of the population depend on food support from WFP and others. You know, my boss, the executive director, David Beasley, he's across the world. Just recently, he was in Ivory Coast, he was in Ethiopia, and, you know, advocating the plight of the people across. Remember the recent incidents of a disaster in Lebanon, he was there. So there is a great solidarity. The fact that we are recognized by the Nobel Prize Committee for our work is an appreciation of values and importance of the World Food Programme, as well as the role the multilateral organization, the UN, plays in promoting peace, in promoting and addressing hunger issues, and the various activities WFP does in addressing hunger. It is the life-saving in emergency. It's also sustaining life and improving life normally. So WFP doesn't just work in emergency context, but take the example of India. We work with government and partner to bring innovation. We transfer of knowledge, technology, and work in hand behind to support our partners across the world.
It's quite interesting to know that 100 million people WFP has been reaching out, and over the years it has earned a lot of, you know, groundswell in terms of the public opinion as well as the policymaker, that the organization has really come in a big way towards helping the people. Now, in this period when we are grappling with the challenges of COVID-19 pandemic, how has WFP as an organization risen up to this challenge?
Very, very sadly, because of COVID, millions of people have lost jobs. So as a result, they are not able to transfer money to their families. People don't have any income. And also there have been difficulty in terms of accessing agriculture inputs or other related support for efficient production of food system. So this has doubled the people needing food, and acute hunger had reached to 270 million. So to reach to this challenge, WFP is really working extremely hard, and we are very concerned. And that's what my boss, the executive director, is appealing across the world. And I'm even appealing to India to join WFP to meet these difficulties in some of the countries where they are really suffering. The hunger level, this doubling to 270 million, is a huge concern. Think of it, it's close to a population of United States, 330 million. So therefore, it's a big number. Now, WFP's response in this context has been from a multiple fold. One is direct food support in countries where they need extra help. So we appeal, we make lots of sort of reach out, and many governments have really increased their support. The United States, for example, has increased their support by almost $2 billion compared to in the past years. Germany has become second largest contributor. United Kingdom, Nordic countries, and lots of private sectors have joined in. Like the program in India, which we are working, are half supported by private sector. So this is one part of it, food support. Second part is direct cash transfer, WFP does. So then it's efficient, it helps choices to the people to diversify food. Third is WFP plays a global leader on logistics, and you know, it helps other organizations and systems to deliver various supplies. In fact, we run planes for the humanitarian workers to fly. We set up hospitals together with the WHO, and we delivered the most urgent needed peas across the world, thousands of tons of supplies. So there is a lot of effort. Yeah. And then we buy commodities locally to help locally or regionally.
Quite a lot of challenges, and with the challenges come the opportunities. As you rightly pointed out, a lot of initiatives have been taken by this world body. Well, India has been a member of World Food Program for quite some time. How has the collaboration between India and this organization progressed over the years?
As I said, we have the World Food Program and Government of India, we have excellent cooperation. I mean, we are here for the last 50 years. This is a 50 years celebration we are making. We work across different ministries. Over the years, the emphasis of WFP program has shifted, rightly so, because India is self-sufficient in food production. So therefore, India doesn't need imported food help like other countries. However, WFP has a huge knowledge base and policy work and cutting edge technologies. So we are working with Ministry of Food in looking at how we can further strengthen the targeted food-based public distribution system there. We have a program in terms of nutritional part, working with the Ministry of Women and Child. We just signed an agreement in front of the Honorable Minister of UP with the additional secretary there and the self-help groups supporting and processing nutrition food in 18 districts with 218 units establishment. We are also working, looking at evidences where there are problems, and then work with the states to address that solution. Like we have an assessment going on in Odisha with the government of Odisha to identify the impact of COVID on livelihood, food security, and look at it to support on in responding. And also the midday meal, which India has, one of the largest in the world, 120 million people. I mean, it's a fantastic example of success and good work. So there we are working to see how we can even further improve. And our effort also goes to take India's example in the neighborhood countries. In fact, we had a minister of education from Bangladesh visiting India to learn about this school meal program. There are officials from Nepal, officials from Bangladesh, even far as Kyrgyzstan and Afghanistan to learn on the public distribution system, the strategic grain reserve mechanism. So we are extending our cooperation and want to do further with the government of India to promote this South-South cooperation and knowledge base and have our partnership further deepened to one is work within India to support India's program. Two is to join hand with India to support other countries in Africa and in the region and developing. Because India has learned so much over the years in development process. I heard many times Honorable Prime Minister saying they want to share experience, they want to support other countries. And I think we want to work with government of India to helping India achieve that result of food security in many other countries.
Yeah, it's something like, you know, the concept like a partner in progress. So that really says the story all about it. Another interesting aspect which we have seen over the years that the government of India, with a series of, you know, the programs and especially related to the food production, India has really maintained self-sustenance in terms of food production. And the progress, it has been quite phenomenal over the past years to say so. How do you look at India's progress? A, in terms of food production, and B, in terms of food security.
That's, to me, heart of my learning and journey. I went to Punjab Agriculture University and studied agriculture in the 70s. And that was the start of the Green Revolution in India. So from that time, where India is still used to import and get lots of wheats from US and other countries, to now, India has 291 million tons of production and 75 million tons as a surplus stock. That's a fantastic example of success. There's no question about it. And also, India plays one of a country exporting a lot of agricultural products. And India's farmer, I have witnessed it in Punjab, very progressive and innovative. And that knowledge has transferred across other states. I was in Odisha and I saw Odisha is sufficient in rice production, for example. Even during this COVID time, you saw witness huge success in farm produce. One of the highest level of production has happened. So that is a good part of it. But what I want to also touch on here is always food production doesn't guarantee to food security. And there are still significant percentage of the people don't have enough to eat and more so enough micronutrients, vitamin and minerals in their day-to-day food intake. And these are fundamental for food security and to eliminate micronutrition. Of course, addition to the good sanitation, good health and livelihood, this is another part of it. And so the effort which India is doing at the moment to address that through Poshan Abhiyan, through the Swachh Bharat, the toilet program, these are brilliant examples. A comprehensive approach to food security, nutrition security. But there is a third component which I want to touch on is the climate change issue. Asia and including India is hugely prone to climate change. And there is, you have seen it in Hyderabad yesterday, and we have witnessed some time back in West Bengal and in Kerala and Odisha, cyclone, all these problems. So this is a recurring phenomenon now. So therefore, adapting to that, to the future, in terms of how to help farmers with this situation and how to prepare is really important. And also in certain areas, there is excessive use of water, for example. I mean, you know, in Punjab, look at it, the water table is going deeper and deeper. And there is excessive production of rice instead of the time I was there, wheat used to be produced. So that has a negative consequence, including the rice burning, which is taking place there. And then the consequence of that to us in Delhi and Haryana and Punjab itself, to our health, is of course a concern. So I think we need to be mindful of these elements of sustainability going forward. So I hope that, and I believe, India would lift itself towards those aspects, because food system constitute production, availability, access, and sustainability. And so we have some element of challenge on food system as a wholesome approach. And therefore, that's what we need to look at it. And I see increasingly discussion food system rather than food production. So we talk about production, we talk about nutritional access, and we talk about the sustainability and saving the other Mother Earth.
Yeah, it really goes along with the theme of the World Food Day this year, which gives a call for, you know, the grow, nourish, sustain. So when we talk about these themes in terms of the World Food Day, for a common man or the listener, how do you explain the theme and the rationale behind these ideas?
I think it's very much linked to exactly the point I was stressing on, because just growing alone is not enough at a mass scale. That has to be accessible and complete with nutrition. And then it's not a one-time growing and eating, but we need that repeatedly. So it's like, let's not kill the gold-laying chicken, correct? So that is as simple as that. But I think the culture and history of India is such, I think if we take that back, there is that Mother Earth and preserving the Mother Earth. I mean, when I grew up as a child in the subcontinent, you know, we used to be taught, don't pollute water in the river, don't litter with plastic and etc. I think we have forgotten that now, sadly. And we need to make everyone responsible, private sector, and make sure that we are not misusing the nature and too much exploiting the nature. And we need to sort of balance that.
You rightly pointed out the context is here is something like you have to A, sustain your livelihood. At the same time, you have to protect the mother nature so that the vagaries of the nature and the climate change do not come as an obstacle in terms of progress of the thing. Another important aspect has been the area of innovation. You see, the World Food Program and the other global agencies, they have been coming out with a series of innovation in terms of zero hunger goal. How do you look at these options and how critical a role these play in terms of the aspects of food security and sustainability?
We are in 21st century. We are reaching to the moon. We are reaching to Mars. So we are so much advanced in technology. And in spite of that, to see people starving and hungry, that is sad. I think that is not acceptable. So we must bring technology to address this issue. Now, in the context of green revolution and production side, that has been brought in through breeding of crops, varieties, and etc. Other thing which is now moving forward is like, you know, artificial intelligence, for example, mapping, identifying where the vulnerability is, preparedness with the weather pattern, if the cyclone is coming or typhoid is coming, you know, forecast of El Nino almost a year in advance and prospect of drought, and then preparing for it. So, and in the micro level of engagement here in India, for example, you know, we have been working with government, India Ministry of Food on this biometric system, this EPOS, this One Nation, One Card. Look at this translation of that technology. You'll be glad to hear. Now we are working with Ministry of Food on a green ATM. So a person with a ration card can just go to the ATM and draw ration. He or she doesn't have to go to the official working hours to a shop to collect his or her ration. So I think there is so much technology happening, and we just need to harness it. One, also, like, you know, we need to produce new varieties of seeds which have a maybe different time zones in production, something which takes less water, for example. And we have already begun that in WFP into these. And then this other part is storage. There is 1/3 of loss takes place between production to consumption. We must preserve that, because if we don't preserve that losses, that means we are wasting resources. We are also consuming energy and the natural resources. So there is huge increasing efforts towards that. And many countries like Europe, zero emission. Some of these countries have, India, you have already started it. Some of the airports in India are completely on solar. And, you know, India has taken leadership. I think there could be more expansion of that solar energy concept in the moving to farmers scale. I saw in Africa, in a remote area, little solar panel put in a hut to charge their phone. See? And now they're connected to the rest of the world. The world has transformed. Simple thing, but it has transformed. So we just have to make sure that it reaches to the people. I mean, the effort India is making, the Prime Minister's initiative about bank account, although it sounds simple, it's a fantastic steps. It empowers women, the ability of food, right type of food, micronutrient, vitamin to children, teaching mothers the right type of food to eat. And also we have a social table that we don't eat this, you don't eat that. And we really need to help change that. So child needs various balanced nutrition before 2 years of age for 80% of brain development. So therefore, that is really fundamental. And we must invest in that, because then you have somebody growing up with full intelligence and full mind.
as you aptly summed up, things like the innovation, the technology, and the sustenance, all of them are interrelated, and they have really played a big role in terms of ensuring the food security as well as a sort of self-reliance on the tools, which will go a long way in addressing the concerns of these nations. And especially in a world like this, where India and the South Asian countries are really trying to have their level best in terms of ensuring food security, it will definitely go a long way in addressing these concerns.
There is one message I want to share. Each of us can make a difference to help improve food security. One, all of us need to also think about other. How can we help other? It's not about giving food, it's about caring. Second is, how do we resource our food? Rather than getting a Californian apple, I want to buy a similar apple. Source your local food so it doesn't need to come from so far with so much energy wasted and etc. And also the governments around the world to prepare and look for the vulnerable communities and care for them and see the changes in climate, how it's happening, and how do we really respond to that in a different way, adaptation, reaching out, supporting vulnerable, etc.
Well, thanks, Mr. Bishow Parajuli, for joining us on the show. And we really hope that in the days and times to come, all these valuable insights will be shared with us and the global community so as to have one unified goal towards food secure world in the years to come. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm very humbled by this opportunity, and I've listened to Air India since childhood. So glad to be here in the studio today. Thank you.
Thank you.